Dear future children, let me tell you the story of my struggle with pre-campus in Cuba, a film about changing racist traditions, and a project that shaped my perception of white fragility and showed me how long and curvy the way really is that is still ahead of us towards you growing up in a better future. But before we come to that cruel racist song that sparked this process, let me share some positive memories of this big part of my childhood and youth.
Wir sind 23 Leute, der Marsch, der steht im Loch. Und auch in dieser Nacht stehen wir auf der Wacht. Am Banner stehen zwei und der Johnny schläft gleich ein.
You guessed right. Johnny, that's me, your future father. These lyrics are from 2004. I didn't have any strong connection to the Altar Servers group since I left to my year abroad in Ghana 2012. Last year, 2019, I wanted to shoot a fictional film in that setting. So I finally returned to this important place of my childhood and youth, the Altar Servers camp of my former church. In the so-called pre-camp, the teenage supervisor set up the camp for the arrival of the children. Former Altar Servers passed by to revive old times. Last year, I was one of them again. For one last time. From an early age, I always went to these holiday camps. One week in the middle of nature, without electricity and running water, with firewood from the nearby forest.
Bin nicht mehr gewohnt, Alter. Ich war, glaube ich, seit 10 Jahren hier beim Bannerstellen dabei.
I would not want to miss these experiences. They shaped my character in many ways. But even though being part of the Altar Servers group and their camps had an overall positive impact on me, today is the day to talk about other aspects. Traditions and responsibility. The night after we realized that the planned film concept didn't work out, I heard this song again.
Aufstand ist in Kuba, Schüsse peitschen durch die Nacht. In der Straße von Havanna werden Reise umgebracht. Umba umba sa umba umba sa umba eo.
The next morning, while everyone else was still asleep, I was restless. The song had triggered an emotional reaction that I couldn't control. A mixture between a feeling of not belonging and failed responsibility. A deep regret about wasted opportunities in speaking up for necessary changes. Since my first camp at the age of 10, I knew this song by heart and was always the loudest one when singing it. It was my favorite campfire song. Aufstand ist in Kuba. Schüsse peitschen durch die Nacht. In den Straßen von Havanna werden Weiße umgebracht. In den Straßen fließt der Eiter, der Verkehr geht nicht mehr weiter. An den Ecken sitzen Knaben, die am Eiter sich erladen. In den Flüssen schwimmen Leichen mit aufgeschlitzten Bäuchen. In den Bäuchen stecken Messer mit der Aufschrift Menschenfresser. Und der Joe mit seinem Messer ist der ärgste Menschenfresser. Schneidet ab nur Ohren und Nasen und versucht dadurch zu blasen. As a child, I didn't really understand the meaning and context and just felt the excitement in singing something that at first sight even seemed funny to me. Later in my youth, I discovered the additional verses printed in my first camp journal from 2004. They were not part of those we had in the songbook, and I didn't remember us singing them even once. Due to them being even more explicit, I became aware of how truly racist the song really is.
Im Gesträuch und im Gestrüppe hängen menschliche Gerippe, und die allein die Kleinen
nagen noch an den Gebeinen. In den Bäumen hängen Leiber, drunter stehen Weiber. Und die denken wie besessen an das nächste Menschenfressen. After that moment of enlightenment, I decided to change nothing. It didn't affect me personally, so I didn't see a need for change, even though I was already part of the supervisors and therefore in a position to make a change. The tradition was stronger than my intellectual understanding that what I continued to sing was racist. The vicious cycle of unquestioned passing on of traditions continued. The children who learned the song from me later passed it on to future generations. After my return from Ghana, I wanted to make up for those missed opportunities and finally change something. I wrote a letter to the group that I have never sent. Now it finally caught up with me. The song and other highly questionable traditions were still around, even though I thought they would have been abolished over time. What changed was the openness to discussion and self-reflection. After I gathered the vim to speak about these traditions, I experienced an honest and open discussion with the teenage camp supervisors.
Was denkst du, warum ich schon seit Jahren nicht mehr dabei bin? Weil ich darüber sprechen will, weil ich das noch nie gemacht habe so? Und weil ich das Gefühl habe, wenn ich mal was mache, dann wird es abgeblockt. Weißt du, wenn ich da, keine Ahnung, wenn ich da irgendwie jetzt gestern drüber geredet hätte, dann wird es halt mit einem blöden Spruch abgeblockt und dann bist du der Depp. Deswegen, ich finde es gut, dass ich das mal mit euch besprechen kann, weil das, ich hab diesen Film, ja, ich wollte einen Film machen und dann, ich wusste gar nicht, warum ich diesen Film machen will. Ich will irgendeinen Film mit dem Zeltlager machen, aber das ist irgendwie so ein, keine Ahnung, jetzt Trauma ist zu viel gesagt, nee, aber mich hat es irgendwie beschäftigt unterbewusst, so, weißt du? Und dann wusste ich aber nicht genau, was mich daran beschäftigt hat. Ich dachte zuerst, okay, das ist vielleicht dieser ganze Alkohol-Ding so. Aber ich hatte ja früher damit auch nicht so die Probleme, dass alle um mich rumsaufen, obwohl ich nicht sauf. Aber ich finde dieses so an alten Dingen festhalten, die eigentlich total überholt sind, finde ich für mich persönlich viel schwieriger. Ich will ja auch jetzt nicht, dass es hier alles im schlechten Licht steht, ja. Weil es ist ja eigentlich ein geiles Lager und wir sind ja auch coole Leute. Es macht ja auch Spaß, es sind Gemeinschaftsdings und es gibt ja keine Nazis unter uns. Wenn jemand dann sagt, okay, das sind da so Nazi-Lieder oder was auch immer, dann ist es ja nicht so gemeint, dass du jetzt ein Nazi bist. Sondern das ist, dass die Gesellschaft, in der wir aufwachsen, unsere Sozialisierung, wie wir da herangeführt werden an die ganzen Sachen, die ist halt rassistisch und sexistisch und noch gegenüber anderen Gruppen diskriminierend. Und wir saugen das alles irgendwie zwar unterbewusst in uns ein, sind eigentlich auch wirklich praktisch nicht wirklich, haben nicht das Gefühl, dass wir da was machen, irgendwie Dings, aber unterbewusst passiert das manchmal vielleicht schon.
Probably you are asking yourself why I'm talking about a discussion, when in fact it sounds like a monologue. And why I'm talking about a camp full of people, when I'm the only one you see. The openness and self-reflection I experienced at the campfire discussion has unfortunately, 1 year later, turned into fear and anger about making the resulting film public. I admit making mistakes in communicating the change from a fictional to a documentary film, but I am also the opinion that what I witnessed from some concerned protagonists and parents was a typical reaction of white people facing and fearing a public discussion about their involvement in structural racism. This reaction is also known as white fragility. In the film, I didn't portray them as racist Nazis, but rather as self-reflected people who realize their group has a problem with racist traditions and who are willing to make a change. I have no doubt that they already changed certain things, but I am still disappointed that they couldn't see the film as a chance to contribute to change outside of their own group. Maybe it could have allowed others to follow their example and openly admit being part of the problem of structural racism and realizing the public responsibility that comes along with that. For me, it seems that in a year where some see Black Lives Matter only as a trending hashtag, it's easier to post a black square on Instagram than to admit in public that one has had racist traditions and is willing to change them. After I nearly faced a court case for the film and was alleged that I am abusing minors for boosting my career, I realized that the way ahead is longer than expected, but it is a way worth going. I will do my best to help spark necessary discussions in society with my films, no matter how difficult it seems. And I hope that those who have put so much energy and dedication into stopping the release of the original film will be able to reflect their white fragility and afterwards put the same energy into making sustainable changes towards a better society. The way seems difficult, but there's light at the end of the tunnel. After returning home, I felt relieved. I was able to confront my past and face my responsibility.
Yo.
Ah! Sorry. Ils sont
épais. Thank you, baby.
Eh ben, mm-hmm. It's dangerous. Hey.
What?
Making this film was a process. At first, it was a film about my past. Then, a film about the camp's present. Now, it's a film about your future. I know you won't have the same childhood as me, but I believe our society can change in a way that will allow you to enjoy similar holiday camps like me, with all the positive aspects I couldn't mention in this film. I want you to be able to smile the same way I was smiling after my first camp. I want those racist traditions to forever remain where they belong, in my past, not in your future. Your future father, Johnny.